Assalamu alaikum students, hope you all are fine. Today we are here to study the external structure of mammals. And let's start with some features of mammals' external structures. Mammals are naturally distributed on all continents except Antarctica, and they live in all oceans. In this section, we will discuss about many adaptations and adaptive additions. The skin of mammal, like that of other vertebrates, consists of epidermal and dermal layers. It protects from mechanical injury, invasions by microorganisms, and the sun's ultraviolet light. Skin is also important in temperature regulation, sensory perception, excretion, and water regulation. In the mammals, the hair is a keratinized derivative of the epidermis of the skin, and it is uniquely mammalian. It is seated in an invagination of the epidermis, and that is called a hair follicle. A coat of hair is called pelage and usually consists of two kinds of hair: long guard hairs, which protect a dense coat of shorter insulating under hairs. Because hair is composed largely of dead cells, it must be periodically molted. In some mammals, like humans, molting occurs gradually and may not be noticed. In others, hair loss occurs rapidly and may result in altered pelage characteristics. In the fall, many mammals acquire a thick coat of insulating underhair, and the pelage color may change. For example, the Arctic fox takes on a white or cream color with its autumn molt, which helps conceal the fox in a snowy environment. With its spring molt, the Arctic fox acquires a gray and yellow pelage. Hair is also important for the sense of touch. Mechanical displacement of the hair stimulates nerve cells associated with the hair root, and the guard hairs may sometimes be modified into thick shafted hairs, which called vibrissae. Vibrissae occur around the legs, nose, mouth, and eyes of many mammals. Their roots are richly innervated and very sensitive to displacement. Air spaces in the hair shaft and air trapped between hair and the skin provide an effective insulating layer. A band of smooth muscle called the erector pili muscle. It runs between the hair follicle and the lower epidermis. When the muscle contracts, the hair stand upright, increasing the amount of air trapped in the pelage and improving its insulating properties. Erector pili muscles are under the control of the autonomic nervous system, and that system also controls the mammal's fight or flight response. In threatening situations, the hair, especially on the neck and on the tail. In the threatening situation, the hair stands on end and may give the perception of increased size and strength. Hair color depends on the amount of pigment. Which pigment? Melanin pigment. It depends on the amount of pigment deposited in it and the quantity of air in the hair shaft. The pelage of most mammals is dark from the above side and the lighter underneath. This pattern makes them less conspicuous around most conditions. Some mammals advertise their defenses using the aposematic coloration. Aposematic coloration is also known as the warning coloration. The contrasting marking of a skunk are a familiar example. Pelage is reduced in large mammals from hot climates, for example, elephants and hippopotamuses. It is also reduced in some aquatic mammals, for example, whales, that often have fatty insulation. A few mammals, like naked mole rat, they have almost no pelage. Claws are present in all amniote classes and they are used for locomotion and offensive and defensive behavior. Claws from accumulation of keratin that cover the terminal phalanx. Phalanx is the bone, terminal bone of the digits. In some mammals, they are specialized to form nails and hooves. The picture on the side of this slide is showing the structure of claws and hooves. A is the claw and B is the hooves. Nails are flattened claws and found on the hands and feet of primates and are an adaptation for arboreal habits where grasping is essential. It is in the B part because first part A is the claws and the C is the hooves. Hooves are characters of the ungulate mammals. The number is reduced and the animals walk on the tips of the remaining digits. These are unguis is a hard keratinized dorsal and subunguis is a softer palate. Now the glands of mammals. Glands dwell from the epidermis. Sebaceous glands are associated with hair follicles and their oily secretion lubricates and waterproofs the skin and hair. Most mammals also possess sudoriferous or sweat glands. Small sweat glands are known as eccrine glands, release watery secretions used in evaporative cooling. Larger sudoriferous glands like apocrine glands secrete a mixture of salt, urea, and water, which microorganisms on the skin convert to odorous product. Scent or musk glands are around the face, feet, or anus of many mammals. These glands secrete pheromones, which may be involved with defense, species and sex recognition, and territorial behavior. Eccrine glands. Of all vertebrates, mammals have the greatest variety of integumentary glands. Most fall into one of four classes: sweat glands, scent glands, sebaceous glands, and mammary glands. All are the derivatives of epidermis. Sweat glands are tubular, highly coiled glands that occur over much of the body surface in most mammals. They are not present in other vertebrates. There are two kinds of sweat glands, eccrine and apocrine glands. Eccrine glands secrete a watery fluid that, if evaporated on the skin surface, draws heat away from the skin and cools it. Eccrine glands occur in hairless regions, especially foot and the foot pads, in most mammals, although in horses and most primates, they are scattered over the body. They are either reduced or absent in the rodents, rabbits, and whales. Next is the apocrine gland. Apocrine glands are larger than the eccrine gland and have longer and more convoluted ducts. Their secretory coil is in the dermis and extend deep into the hypodermis. They always open into a hair follicle or where a hair once was. Apocrine glands dwell near puberty and are restricted in humans to the axillae. In contrast to watery secretions of eccrine glands, apocrine secretions are milky floods, whitish or yellow in color, that dry on the skin to form a film. Apocrine glands are not involved in heat regulations. Their activity is correlated with reproductive functions and signals such things as cycle stage and receptivity in the female and degree of maturity and relatedness of individuals within a species. Apocrine glands dwell near puberty and are restricted in humans to the armpits, breast, prepuce, scrotum, and external auditory canals. Scent glands occur in nearly all mammals, and their location and functions vary greatly. They are used for communication with members of the same species, for marking territorial boundaries, for warning, or for defense. Scent-producing glands are located in the orbital, metatarsal, and interdigital regions. Behind the eyes and on the cheek, base of the tail, back of the head, and anal region. The latter, the most odoriferous of all glands, open by ducts into the anus. Their secretions can be discharged forcefully for 2 to 3 meters. During mating season, many mammals give off strong scent for attracting the opposite sex. Humans also are endowed with scent glands, however, we tend to dislike our own scent, a concern that has stimulated a lucrative deodorant industry to produce an endless output of soaps and odor making conscious. Sebaceous glands are intimately associated with hair follicles. Although some are free and open directly into the surface, the cellular lining of the gland is discharged in the secretory process and must be renewed for further secretion. These gland cells become distended with fatty accumulation, then die, and are expelled as a greasy mixture called the sebum into the hair follicle. It is called a polite fat because it does not turn rancid. It serves as a dressing to keep skin and hair pliable and glossy. Most mammals have sebaceous glands over their entire body. In humans, they are most numerous in the scalp and on the face. This is the structure of human skin. It is showing the epidermis and dermis and hypodermis, which showing the hair and glands. The sebaceous glands, erector pili muscles, nerve endings, hair follicle, sweat gland, hypodermis included these subcutaneous layer, dermis and epidermis, and the hair. नेक्स्ट इज द हॉर्न्स एंड एंटलर्स, अनदर एक्सटर्नल स्ट्रक्चर. सेवरल काइंड्स ऑफ हॉर्न्स और हॉर्न लाइक स्ट्रक्चर्स आर फाउंड इन मैमल्स. ट्रू हॉर्न्स फाउंड इन मेंबर्स ऑफ फैमिली बोविडी, फॉर एग्जाम्पल शीप एंड कैटल, आर होलो शीट्स ऑफ केराटिनाइज्ड एपिडर्मिस दैट एम्ब्रेस अ कोर ऑफ बोन अराइजिंग फ्रॉम द स्कल. ट्रू हॉर्न्स आर नॉट शेड, आर नॉट ब्रांच्ड, ग्रो कॉन्टिन्यूसली एंड अकर इन बोथ सेक्सेस. एंटलर्स ऑफ द डियर फैमिली सर्विडी आर ब्रांच्ड एंड कंपोज्ड ऑफ सॉलिड बोन व्हेन मैच्योर. ड्यूरिंग देयर एनुअल स्प्रिंग ग्रोथ एंटलर्स ड्वेल बीनीथ अ कवरिंग ऑफ हाईली वस्कुलर सॉफ्ट स्किन कॉल्ड द वेलवेट. एक्सेप्ट फॉर कैरिबो ओनली मेल्स ऑफ द स्पीशीज प्रोड्यूस एंटलर्स. When growth of the antlers is complete, just before the fall breeding season, blood vessels constrict and a stag removes the velvet by rubbing its antlers against trees. Antlers are shed after the breeding season. New birds appear a few months later to herald the next set of antlers. For several years, each new pair of antlers is larger and more elaborate than the previous set. And both of antlers strains mineral metabolism, since during the growing season, an older moose or elk must accumulate 50 or more pounds of calcium salts from its vegetable diet. Horns of the pronghorned antelope from the family Antilocapridae are similar to true horns of bovids, except that the keratinized portion is forked and shed annually. Giraffe horns are similar to antlers but retain their integumentary covering and are not shed. In this picture, you can see the annual growth of buck deer antlers. In the picture A, antlers begin growth in late spring and stimulated by pituitary gonadotrophins. In the B picture, bone grows very rapidly until halted by a rapid rise in testosterone production by the testes. C is the skin velvet dies and sloughs off. D is the testosterone levels peak during the fall breeding season. Antlers are shed in January as testosterone levels subside. The next gland is the mammary gland. Mammary glands are functional in female mammals and are present but non-functional in males. The milk that mammary gland secretes contains water, carbohydrates, especially the sugar lactose, fat, protein, minerals, and antibodies. Mammary glands are probably derived evolutionarily from apocrine glands and usually contain substantial fatty deposits. Monoderms have mammary glands that lack nipples. The gland discharges milk into depressions on the belly where the young lap it up. In other mammals, mammary glands open via nipples or tears and the young suckle for their nourishment. Mammary glands, for which mammals are named, occur on all female mammals and in a rudimentary form on all male mammals. They develop by thickening the epidermis to form a milk line along each side of the abdomen in the embryo. On certain parts of these lines, the mammae appear while the intervening parts of the ridges disappear. Mammary glands increase in size at maturity, becoming considerably larger during the pregnancy and subsequent nursing of young. In human females, adipose tissue begins to accumulate around the mammary glands at puberty to form the breast. In most mammals, milk is secreted from mammary glands via nipples or tears, but monotremes lack nipples and simply secrete milk into a depression on the mother's belly where it is lapped by the younger, I have told you earlier. Mammary glands are specialized to secrete milk following the birth of young. In the picture A, many ducts lead from the glands to a nipple. Parts of the duct system are enlarged to store milk. Suckling by an infant initiates a hormonal response that causes the mammary gland to release milk. And in the diagram B, some mammals, for example, like cattle, have teats that form by the extension of a collar of skin around the opening of a mammary duct. Milk collects in a large cistern prior to its release. The number of nipples or teats varies with the number of young produced. Next is the skull and teeth. The skulls of mammals show important modification of the reptilian pattern. One feature that zoologists use to distinguish reptilian from mammalian skull is the method of jaw articulation. In reptiles, the jaw articulates at two small bones at the rear of the jaw. While in mammals, these bones have moved into the middle ear and along with the stapes form the middle ear ossicle. A single bone of the lower jaw articulates the mammalian jaw. A secondary palate evolved twice in vertebrates, in the archosaur lineage and in the synapsid lineage. You can see in that picture, in some theropsids, small shelf-like extensions of the bone partially separated the nasal and oral passageways. In mammals, the secondary palate extends posteriorly by a fold of skin, which is called the soft palate, which almost completely separates the nasal passages from the mouth cavity. Unlike other vertebrates that swallow food whole or in small pieces, some mammals chew their food. The most extensive secondary palate allows mammals to breathe while chewing. Breathing needs to stop only briefly during the swallowing. When you are swallowing the food, you cannot breathe. It is a fact and you can try it. So what is the arrangement of teeth? Arrangement of teeth are important indicators of mammalian lifestyle. In reptiles, the teeth are uniformly conical, a condition referred to as homodont. In mammals, the teeth are often specialized for different functions, and this condition is called heterodont. When the teeth perform special and different functions, these are known as heterodont. While when the teeth perform a uniform or a single function, it is known as homodont. Reptilian teeth attach along the top or inside of the jaw, whereas in mammals, the teeth are set into sockets of the jaw. Most mammals have two sets of teeth during their lives. The first teeth emerge before or shortly after birth, and these are called deciduous or milk teeth. These teeth are lost and permanent teeth replace them. Adult mammals have up to four kinds of teeth: incisors, canines, premolars and molars. Incisors are the most anterior teeth in the jaw. They are usually chisel-like and used for the gnawing or nipping. Canines are often long, stout, and conical and are usually used for catching, killing, and tearing the prey. Canines and incisors have single roots. Premolars are positioned next to canines and have one or two roots and tunicated surfaces for chewing. Molars have broad chewing surfaces and two upper molars or three lower molar roots. The picture is showing the secondary palate. The secondary palate, consisting of the hard and soft palates of a mammal, almost completely separates the nasal and oral cavity. The breathing is stopped only momentarily during the swallowing. Mammalian species have characteristic number of each kind of adult tooth. Zoologists use a dental formula to characterize taxa. It is an expression of the number of teeth of each kind in one half of the upper and lower jaws. The teeth of the upper jaw are listed above those of the lower jaw and in the following order: incisors, canines, premolars, and molars. For example, when you divide your upper jaw into half, the one side is the mirror image to the other side, and the one side showing the upper side of the dental formula, while the lower jaw's one side showing the lower side of the dental formula. Mammalian teeth may be specialized for particular diets. In some mammals, the dentition is reduced, sometimes to the point of having no teeth. For example, armadillos are the giant anteater. Feed on the termites and ants, and their teeth are reduced because the ants and the termites no need to chewing. So their teeth are reduced. Some mammals like humans from the order primates and Artiodactyla order are omnivorous. They feed on a variety of plants, animals. They have anterior teeth with sharp ripping and piercing surfaces and posterior teeth with flattened grinding surfaces for rupturing plant cell walls. In this picture, you can see the different specializations of teeth. The first A picture is of an omnivore, Homo sapiens. The second is an herbivore, the male fallow deer, Demodema. And the third C picture is a rodent, and the D picture is of a carnivore. They are showing the different specialized type of teeth according to their feeding habits. Mammals that eat plant material often have flat, grinding posterior teeth and incisors, and sometimes have canines modified for nipping plant matter. For example, horses from the order Perissodactyla, deer from the order Artiodactyla. And some are modified for gnawing. For example, in the rabbits from the order Lagomorpha and the beavers from the order Rodentia. In rodents, the incisors grow throughout the life. Although most mammals have enamel covering the entire tooth, rodents have enamel only on the front surfaces of their incisors. The teeth are kept sharp by slower wear in front than in back, and the gap is called the diastema, which separates the anterior food procuring teeth from the posterior grinding teeth. The diastema results from an elongation of the snout that allows the anterior teeth to reach closer to the ground or into narrow opening to procure food. The posterior teeth have a high exposed surface, which is known as crown, and continuous growth, which allows these teeth to withstand years of grinding tough vegetation. Predatory mammals use canines and incisors for killing and tearing the prey. In mammals of the order Carnivora, for example, dogs and cats, the fourth upper premolar and first lower molars have a scissor-like shearing surface, which is called the carnassial apparatus, and that is used for cutting flesh from the prey. This picture is showing the feeding specializations of major trophic groups of eutherian mammals. Early eutherian were insectivores. All other types are descended from them. In the lower side of the picture, you can see the early insectivores with generalized dentition, while on the right side, from the upper, there is herbivore gnawing and grazing, brawing type of teeth specialization, while in the left side you can see the carnivorous type of teeth specialization and frugivorous, then derived insectivorous, omnivorous and passivorous and plankton feeders. This is a complete history of the eutherian mammals according to their specialization of feeding habits. So it was all about the external structures of the mammals and their functions, and also about their history. So if you have any question, you can ask. Thank you.